Welcome to this Good Friday meditation service. This is a service held jointly with the Montebello Plymouth Congregational Church. Good morning, or good afternoon, or good evening, depending on what time you may be watching or viewing this meditation service. My name is Mitchell Young, and I serve as a pastor here at Montebello Plymouth Congregational Church. And along with our lay reader, Kuni K, and our broadcast worship team, Eileen, our musician, and our technical staff today, BJ and Stephen, we welcome the San Marino Congregational Church with Pastor Donald, as well as their reader, Pat B, and the Covina Community Congregational Church, Covina Community Church, United Church of Christ. We're all United Churches of Christ, with Pastor Lee, as well as Dr. Mika, as their lay reader. We welcome all of you to this time of meditation. And today's meditation will follow the tradition of the Stations of the Cross, or the Way of the Cross, known also as the Way of Sorrows, or the Via Crucis, a way of using a series of images depicting Jesus Christ on the day of his crucifixion and accompanying prayers. Now, traditionally, these images would be placed around a worship space, and the participants of the meditation service would spend a few minutes at each of those stations for prayer and reflection. However, since we are not gathered physically in the same space, we will virtually and in spirit walk through the stations together. And each station will be accompanied by a scripture reading and a prompt for prayer and reflection. I'll give you some instructions in between each of the scripture readings for your benefit. If you just want to let the whole video run right through, it'll probably take a little bit more than half an hour. But if you do want to spend more time, feel free to pause in between to do more reflecting as I prompt you for the reflection times. So for today's service and meditation, you may choose to have a sheet of paper with you. It can be any kind of paper, scratch paper, blank, but at least one side of it blank for your writing. So of course you'll need something to write with, a pen or a pencil, and keep those at hand. And I will give you other prompts along the way. So with that, let us now enter into this time of meditation. Cross in quarantine.
Luke, chapter 22, verses 39 through 44. He came out and went, as was his custom, to the Mount of Olives, and the disciples followed him. When he reached the place, he said to them, "Pray that ye may not come into the time of trial." Then he withdrew from them about a stone's throw, knelt down, and prayed. "Father, if you are willing, remove this cup from me. Yet not my will, but yours be done." Then an angel from heaven appeared to him and gave him strength. In his anguish, he prayed more earnestly, and his sweat became like great drops of blood falling down on the ground.
We all know too well what it feels like to be alone. You can press pause and spend a few moments alone in prayer.
Station 2, Chains, Lee Yates. Matthew 26, 47 through 56. While he was still speaking, Judas, one of the 12, arrived. With him was a large crowd, swords and clubs, from the chief priests and the elders of the people. Now the betrayer had given them a sign saying, "The one I kiss is the man. Arrest him." At once he came up to Jesus and said, "Greetings, Rabbi," and kissed him. Jesus said to him, "Friend, do what you are here to do." Then they came and laid hands on Jesus and arrested him. Suddenly, one of those with Jesus put his hand on his sword, drew it, and struck the slave of the high priest, cutting off his ear. Then Jesus said to him, "Put your sword back in its place, for all who take up the sword will perish by the sword. Do you think I cannot appeal to my Father, and God will at once send more than 12 legions of angels? But how then would the scriptures be fulfilled, which say it must happen this way?" At that hour, Jesus said to the crowds, "Have you come out with swords and clubs to arrest me, as though I were a bandit? Day after day, I sat in the temple teaching, and you did not arrest me. But all of this is to take place, so that the scriptures of the prophets might be fulfilled." Then all the disciples deserted him and fled.
Jesus felt the weight of chains on his hands as the guards took him away. So now I invite you to spend a moment of reflection on chains. What weighs you down? What makes you feel pressed down? And in what ways have you bound others by chains? You may press pause and spend a moment in reflection.
Good Friday service, station 3, I Am. This is from Mark 14, verses 61 to 64. But he was silent and did not answer. Again, the high priest asked him, "Are you the Messiah, the Son of the Blessed One?" Jesus said, "I am. And you will see the Son of Man seated at the right hand of the power and coming with the clouds of heaven." Then the high priest tore his clothes and said, "Why do we still need witnesses? You have heard his blasphemy. What is your decision?" All of them condemned him as deserving death.
Jesus answered the Jewish leaders' questions about whether he was the Messiah by admitting, "I am." This enraged the leaders because Jesus called himself the I Am, which could be taken as a Hebrew expression referring to God. God revealed God's self to Moses with the name through the burning bush. And now we encounter God's self-revelation through the person of Jesus. So now, reflect. How is God revealing God's self to you in this season?
Kunikanegai, station number 4. Then Pilate entered the headquarters again, summoned Jesus and asked him, "Are you the King of the Jews?" Jesus answered, "Do you ask this on your own, or did others tell you about me?" Pilate replied, "I am not a Jew, am I? Your own nation and chief priests have handed you over to me. What have you done?" Jesus answered, "My kingdom is not from this world. If my kingdom were from this world, my followers would be fighting to keep me from being handed over to the Jews. But as it is, my kingdom is not from here." Pilate asked him, "So you are a king?" Jesus answered, "You say that I am a king. For this I was born, and for this I came into the world, to testify to the truth. Everyone who belongs to the truth listens to my voice."
Pilate wanted to know, "Jesus, are you a king? Do you wear the royal colors?" The Roman governor mocked Jesus as he spoke about the kingdom of God. We all have expectations of what a kingdom should be. So for a moment, I invite you to reflect. What kind of expectation do you have for a kingdom or a government? And how is that different from the way that Jesus rules? What do you think Jesus did that was so upsetting to the political and religious leaders? You may pause for a moment of reflection.
This is Pastor Donald's first reading. Station 5, Matthew 27, 15 through 24. Now at the festival, the governor was accustomed to release a prisoner for the crowd, anyone whom they wanted. At that time, they had a notorious prisoner called Jesus Barabbas. So after they had gathered, Pilate said to them, "Whom do you want me to release for you, Jesus Barabbas or Jesus who is called the Messiah?" For he realized that it was out of jealousy that they had handed him over. While he was sitting on the judgment seat, his wife sent word to him, "Have nothing to do with that innocent man, for today I have suffered a great deal because of a dream about him." Now the chief priests and the elders persuaded the crowds to ask for Barabbas and to have Jesus killed. The governor again said to them, "Which of the two do you want me to release for you?" And they said, Pilate said to them, "Then what should I do with this Jesus who is called the Messiah?" All of them said, "Let him be crucified." And he asked, "Why? What evil has he done?" But they shouted all the more, "Let him be crucified." So when Pilate saw that he could do nothing, but rather that a riot was beginning, he took some water, and he washed his hands before the crowd, saying, "I am innocent of this man's blood. See to it yourselves."
When Pilate washes his hands before the crowd, it is a symbol that he did not want to have any part of the execution of that innocent person, even though he had the power to stop it. There have been times throughout history when rulers and governors have given in to public pressure, even at the cost of justice that the innocent have suffered. We too avoid taking responsibility for participating in injustice and sin in our world today. Whether it's avoidance, blaming other people, distracting ourselves with other matters, I invite you now to get up from where you are and go to your bathroom or your kitchen sink and wash your hands for 30 seconds. If you don't have access to a sink, simply rub your hands together for 30 seconds. And I don't want you to just imagine the coronavirus pathogens that you have been washing down the sink all this past year, but I want you to think also of the guilt that you have tried to wash away in those times when you didn't stand up to injustice in our world, when you know you could have. Pause. You can press pause and you'll be right here when you come back.
John chapter 19, verse 5. So Jesus came out wearing the crown of thorns and the purple robe. Pilate said to them, "Here is the man."
Spend a moment, meditate on these thorns. Imagine being whipped and beaten, bruised and stripped. Imagine someone placing thorns on the top of your head. Tiny drops of blood surface at each place where the thorn pierces your scalp.
Good Friday, Station 7, Heavy. This is from John 10, verses 17 to 18. For this reason, the Father loves me, because I lay down my life in order to take it up again. No one takes it from me, but I lay it down of my own accord. I have power to lay it down, and I have power to take it up again. I have received this command from my Father.
Jesus carried a heavy cross a long distance. I want you to imagine, what's the heaviest thing that you have carried? You can take this physically or metaphorically. How did you feel when you were carrying all of that weight upon you? What kind of pain did you experience as you carried such a heavy burden?
Station 8. Funny kind of guy. As they led him away, they seized a man, Simon of Cyrene, who was coming from the country, and they laid the cross on him and made him carry it behind Jesus.
So Simon was pulled into Jesus' suffering, even though he was an outsider coming in from a different area. So I invite you to take this time to pause and reflect on what it is like to observe suffering from the outside. Think about how you might be called to help ease suffering of another human being. What cross might God be calling you to carry for someone else?
Lee Yates, Station 9, Weep. Luke 23, 27 through 31. A great number of people followed him, and among them were women who were beating their breasts and wailing for him. But Jesus turned to them and said, "Daughters of Jerusalem, do not weep for me, but weep for yourselves and for your children. For the days are surely coming when they would say, 'Blessed are the barren, and the wombs that never bore, and the breasts that never nursed.' Then they will begin to say to the mountains, 'Fall on us,' and to the hills, 'Cover us.' For if they do this when the wood is green, what will happen when it is dry?"
So Jesus told the women not to weep for him, but to weep for themselves and to weep for the world. I invite you now to pause and reflect. What makes you weep?
This is Pastor Donald's second reading for Station 10, Luke 23, 33 to 34. When they came to the place that is called the Skull, they crucified Jesus there with the criminals, one on his right and one on his left. Then Jesus said, "Father, forgive them, for they do not know what they are doing." And they cast lots to divide his clothing.
Even as Jesus suffered the excruciating pain of being crucified, he found enough mercy within himself to offer forgiveness, even for those who were crucifying him, for they didn't know what they were doing. Think back in a time in your life when you participated in an act of cruelty, as did those who divided his clothes even as he hung on the cross. Which, perhaps, the cruelty that you did not even see at that time. But now that you stand back and realize how you have treated another human being as less than human, how could you not know what you are doing?
Luke 23, 39 through 43. One of the criminals who were hanged there kept deriding him and saying, "Are you not the Messiah? Save yourself and us." But the other one rebuked him, saying, "Do you not fear God, since we are under the same sentence of condemnation? And we indeed have been condemned justly, for we are getting what we deserve for our deeds. But this man has done nothing wrong." Then he said, "Jesus, remember me when you come into your kingdom." He replied, "Truly, I tell you, today, you will be with me in paradise."
Jesus spent the last hours of his life between two crucified criminals. They had no time to discuss their, they had enough time to discuss their inevitable deaths. So I invite you to, wherever you are now, to stand up if you are able, to hold your arms stretched out to both sides of your body to form a cross and leave them that way for 30 seconds. If you are strong, leave them that way for a minute.
Good Friday, Station 12. Goodbye. This is from John 19, verses 25b to 27. Meanwhile, standing near the cross of Jesus were his mother and his mother's sister Mary, the wife of Clopas, and Mary Magdalene. When Jesus saw his mother and the disciple whom he loved standing beside her, he said to his mother, "Woman, here is your son." Then he said to the disciple, "Here is your mother." And from that hour, the disciple took her into his own home.
Jesus' mother and friends and family came to see Jesus while he was being crucified. And in this exchange between his mother and John, the disciple whom Jesus loved, Jesus is asking John to look after his mother once he is gone. Imagine having to say goodbye to someone you love, knowing very well that you may never see them again in this life. And if you feel led, write one or two sentences as a note to someone in your family, whether they are alive or have they passed into glory. And you don't have to share it with them. But I invite you to commit to paper and to say things that you need to say to them.
This is Pastor Donald's third reading for Station 13, John 19, 28 through 34. After this, when Jesus knew that all was now finished, he said, in order to fulfill the scripture, "I am thirsty." A jar full of sour wine was standing there. So they put a sponge full of the wine on a branch of hyssop and held it to his mouth. When Jesus had received the wine, he said, "It is finished." And he bowed his head and gave up his spirit. Since it was the day of preparation, the Jews did not want the bodies left on the cross during the Sabbath, especially because that Sabbath was a day of great solemnity. So they asked Pilate to have the legs of the crucified men broken and the bodies removed. Then the soldiers came and broke the legs of the first and of the other who had been crucified with him. But when they came to Jesus and saw that he was already dead, they did not break his legs. Instead, one of the soldiers pierced his side with a spear, and at once blood and water came out.
I invite you to meditate on Jesus' last moments on earth. Since last Good Friday, we experienced last year, there have been so many moments of death and hopelessness, feeling like some lives mattered more than others, feeling frustrated by those who refused to take the deadly disease seriously, feeling like though a world divided might never come together as one. We experienced many kinds of death. So now I invite you to take a sheet of paper and to write down the variety of deaths that you have experienced this past year, whether actual deaths of loved ones or things in your life that are gone forever. What griefs have you borne this past year? Take a few minutes, write them down on a piece of paper, and come back when you're ready.
Station 14, Barry, Lee Yates. John 19, 38 through 42. After these things, Joseph of Arimathea, who was a disciple of Jesus, though a secret one because of his fear of the Jews, asked Pilate to let him take away the body of Jesus. Pilate gave him permission, so he came and removed the body. Nicodemus, who had first come to Jesus by night, also came, bringing a mixture of myrrh and aloes, weighing about 100 pounds. They took the body of Jesus and wrapped it with the spices and linen cloths, according to the burial custom of the Jews. Now there was a garden in the place where he was crucified. In the garden there was a new tomb in which no one had ever been laid. And so because it was the Jewish day of preparation and the tomb was nearby, they laid Jesus there.
So after Jesus' death, his followers laid him in a tomb, feeling incredibly hopeless. Yet I also want us to remember that Jesus' death was the beginning of a great victory. When Jesus died, all our own struggles and hopelessness, all of our own doubt and despair, all died too. Of course, that doesn't mean we're going to always feel good, because we worship a God who felt immense pain and hopelessness and despair and even experienced death. Death on a cross as well. So we remember Christ, who is with us in our pain and our suffering right now. I want you to take that sheet of paper that you were writing on, that sheet of paper that holds your struggles, that marks moments of death. And now, our church choir, even though we physically cannot be together, in spirit, our voices have been electronically gathered thanks to modern technology. And also thanking Aldrin G for mixing our voices together. And as you hear the choir sing, I want you to take that paper that holds your burdens, your griefs, your deaths, and tear it into as many bits of paper as you can. And imagine the mercy that God extends to all of us, even in our moments of struggle and death, as we look forward to God's victory over death in the resurrection to come.
Once was bright as morn.
now that you have torn your struggles and your deaths into bits, in your own time, I invite you to bury those bits of paper representing your torn up deaths and moments of struggle into a recycling bin, or perhaps into your garden, which symbolizes the tomb. And know that out of death comes new life. We thank you all for joining us today on this Good Friday meditation. We thank Covina Community Church, San Marino Congregational Church, as well as all of you in our own beloved Montebello Plymouth Congregational. So we ask that you keep the vigil, keep the faith and the vigil through the rest of Good Friday, as well as Holy Saturday. There will be no benediction at this time because the events of this day do not conclude until Easter resurrection morning. And now, let us depart in silence.